Good afternoon, everybody. Today's class is on CTEV. CTEV means congenital telepus equinovarus. As the name indicates, its deformity, it's a congenital one. That means another variant, idiopathic variant, is there. It's a developmental. This one is congenital, means present since birth. Telepus, tali means, it indicates talus. Pus means foot. So the whole pathology is surrounded around the talus. So talus, foot, telepus. And equino means plantar flexion. Plantar flexion means in horse, like a horse foot. It is in a plantar flexion. So it is called equino. Varus means inward deviation of the foot. So the name indicates the deformity. It is a congenital one, concentrated around the talus, and pathology concentrated around talus and plantar flexion and varus. So it is a most common congenital deformity of foot and ankle. It occurs in 1 in 1,000 live births. So I already told you the deformities are plantar flexion at angle, inversion of the foot, adduction of the forefoot, and medial rotation. So plantar flexion, inversion of foot, adduction, and medial rotation of the foot, and cavus deformity. And there are associated secondary deformities. Means foot size is very, very much reduced up to 50%. The medial border is concave and the lateral border is convex. And a lot of callosities over the dorsum of the foot if the child is weight bearing and walking on that foot. And hypertrophic or absent anterior tibial artery and muscles atrophy. Before going into detail, we must know some of the anatomy of the foot. Foot is divided into forefoot, midfoot, and hindfoot. Forefoot is phalanx and metatarsals constitute the forefoot. Navicular, cuneiform, and cuboid constitutes the midfoot. Calcaneum and talus constitutes the hindfoot. So foot is divided into forefoot, midfoot, and hindfoot. And movements at the ankle and the foot. At the dorsiflexion and plantar flexion occurs at the ankle joint level. And at the level of hindfoot, eversion and inversion occurs. So eversion and inversion occurs at the hindfoot. And abduction and adduction occurs at the forefoot. So at the tarsometatarsal junction. So adduction and abduction at the forefoot level, that is tarsometatarsal junction. At the level of hindfoot, eversion and inversion. And at the level of ankle, dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. And another movement is a supination and pronation. So in foot and ankle, the movements are not individual movements. Per se, if it is an eversion is not an, you can't produce a single eversion of the foot. It is always associated with dorsiflexion and abduction. So these all three movements constitute pronation. And supination is inversion, plantar flexion, and adduction. So it is a combination of the movement. These movements are kinematically coupled, means one movement produces another movement. If you want to produce adduction, the foot automatically goes into the inversion and plantar flexion. If you want to put your foot in abduction, it automatically produces a hyperflexion and eversion movement. So these are kinematically coupled movements. So one movement is affects the other movement. This principle was used by Fonseca to treat the correction of the deformity. And coming to the history, there was a lot of theories. First described by Hippocrates and a tenotomy of tendericles done by Lorenz and POP wedging done by kites. And most of the research works are done by kite and Ponseti. Ponseti is the one which describes the conservative management of CTV. Coming to the etiology, there is a lot of theories, that is germplasm theory and nuclear theory. So many theories are there. None of them are 100% correct. According to Stalwart, it may be a hereditary one. And according to Tubby, it is an arrested development. So some say it is a bony abnormality. Some say it is a only soft tissue problem, which later secondary bony changes occur. Some say it is a primary bony abnormality, due to which soft tissue contracture occurs. So another one is due to neurological, mostly idiopathic club foot. In idiopathic club foot, neurological conditions may associate. And some say it is maybe muscular, microfibroblastic, and intrauterine. Some say it, due to intrauterine position, malposition of the fetus, the foot may go into the cavus, CTV. So the bones affected are talus, calcaneum, navicular, and cuboid. And the joints affected are ankle, posterior talocalcaneal, talocalcaneum navicular, and calcaneum cuboid. And the ligaments are medial side deltoid ligament, that is medial collateral ligament of the ankle. This is the deltoid ligament. Deltoid ligament has a superficial and deep part. Only superficial part is contracted, deep is not contracted. And spring is calcaneonavicular ligament. Calcaneonavicular ligament, spring ligament. And other capsules of the talocalcaneal tarsal bones and talonavicular and talocalcaneal capsules are contracted. And interosseous ligament, that is talocalcaneal ligament. And plantar ligaments. All these ligaments are contracted. And coming to the tendons on the medial aspect, tibial is posterior, flexor hallux is longus, and flexor digitorum longus. This FHL and FDL forms a knot at the level of the crossing below the base of the metatarsal. These both tendon cross through a tunnel that is called master knot of Henry's. During the release, the master knot of Henry must be released. The muscle contracted are gastrocnemius, tibialis anterior, tibialis posterior, EHL, peroneus longus. Now, coming to the nomenclature, I already told you, equinus is foot is fixed in plantar flexion. Calcaneus means foot is fixed in dorsiflexion. Calcaneo valgus is another deformity. Okay. Varus is inverted and adducted. Valgus means inverted and abducted. Supination is a combination of movement, and pronation also I already told you. Cavus is longitudinal arch is exaggerated. Planus means longitudinal arch is flattened. So coming to the clinical feature, mostly it is a clinical diagnosis. No need of any investigations. The foot appears to be small, and there is increased medial curvature. The medial aspect is concave, and the lateral border is more convex. And there is adduction deformity, and the skins, you can see some callosities if it is a neglected case. And you can feel the talar head, which is just below the medial malleus. And the heel is also small compared to the lateral side. How will you identify a club foot in a newborn? Based on the dorsiflexion test. In a newborn, it is possible to dorsiflex the foot till it touches the anterior border of the leg. So you can, when you dorsiflex the foot, it will touches the anterior border of the leg. In CTEV, it is not possible because the foot is fixed in plantar flexion. Another one is plumb line test. Plumb line test to measure the tibial torsion. I already told you at the deformities, there is an increased medial rotation of the tibia. That is, tibial torsion is increased. Normally, there is a tibial torsion at the birth. This tibial torsion is more increased in CTEV. A line is drawn from the center of patella through the tibial tuberosity, passes through the first or the second metatarsal space. Another one is scratch test. Medial scratch test. When medial sole is scratched, the forefoot inverts. When the lateral sole is scratched, the foot is inverts. This is lateral scratch test. And if you notice, this is the talus and this is the calcaneum. In a normal view, it forms some angle with the both. In a radiograph, you can measure that angle. What happens in CTV, the calcaneum is rotated under the talus, rotated medially under the talus. So the deformity occurs. So cavus, equinus, adduction, inversion, and cavus. These are the deformities. Cavus occurs due to the flexion of the first first tarsal metatarsal hyperflexion produces cavus. So I already told you about supination and pronation. These are combination of movements. The hind foot is in supination and the forefoot is in pronation relative to the hind foot. So primary is the difference between the congenital and idiopathic one. Idiopathic one is present since birth, and most of these cases are bilateral. In secondary, these are unilateral and occurs sometimes after birth, and it is a idiopathic. Exact cause is not known, and it is a developmental one. In primary, the foot size is much smaller and compared to the opposite side. In secondary, the foot may be normal and the heel size also normal in idiopathic variant. And skin appears to be chubby and creases are present. In the idiopathic one, the skin is atrophic and creases are absent. And nervous system is normal in CTV, but in idiopathic, mostly it may be due to neuromuscular causes. And congenital one, the prognosis is good. After correction, whether it's conservative or surgically, the foot may comes to near normal, that is plantigrade foot. In idiopathic, the cause may be neuromuscular cause. So the results are very poor. Coming to the radiological features, most of the cases are the CTV is diagnosed clinically. Radiologically, in newborn, most of the bones may not appear in a newborn. So no need of taking a radiograph in a newborn. So up to 3 to 4 years, the use of X-ray is very minimal, just for a namesake. X-ray can be done only after it is useful after 2 to 3 years only. I already told you this talus is medial and calcaneus lateral. In what have it forms an angle around 20 to 25 degrees, that is talocalcaneal angle. This talocalcaneal angle in lateral view. What happens in lateral view is these line drawn along the talus and calcaneum are almost parallel in a lateral. Here the angle is decreased. In lateral view, calcaneum metatarsal angle also be done. Prenatal diagnosis. CTV can be diagnosed intrauterinely by ultrasound. Mostly these cases can be diagnosed after first trimester, that is around 20 weeks, you can diagnose intrauterinely whether club foot is there or not. Here is the ultrasound. This is the normal foot. This is the club foot. Here, this is the club foot. And MRI is not routinely done. And coming to the classification, there is two classification, mainly two classification, Pirani scoring system and Demigler classification. These are based on the amount of the deformity and the correction of the deformity, how much we can correct. So Pirani, six parameters are taken. So in the midfoot, curved lateral border, according to this, mild, moderate and severe points are given, 0.5 and 1 is the severe, in severe case. In medial foot crease, again mild, moderate, severe, and talar head coverage, that is the distance between the talar head and medial malleus, this is measured. Again, it is mild, moderate, severe. Coming to the hind foot, posterior creases and rigid equinus and empty heel, all these depend on the grades, 0.5 and 1 is given. The maximum score is 6, minimum is 0. Higher the score, the more severe the deformity and less chance of recurrence or response to the treatment. This is the rigid equinus. This is 0. You can see some amount of the deformity is some flexible, that is, it can be dorsiflexed mildly. And 0.5 is you can't bring the foot up to plantigrade foot, that is 0 degrees. Here it is complete resistant. 1 means empty heel means 0, heel is almost full. 0.5 is heel size is decreased, and 1 is more, heel is very small. And posterior is easily palpable is 1, palpable 0.05, and not palpable 1. And a curved lateral border, you can put in a straight scale so that amount of the displacement can be mild, moderate and severe. And medial crease also palpable, not palpable. Not palpable means 1. Lateral head of the talus, if it is not palpable, 0, partial 0.5, full is 1. Another scoring system is Demigler scoring system. Based on this, 4 grades are given, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 is benign, 2 is moderate, 3 is severe, and 4 is very severe. So this is based on the amount of the deformity, and the degree of deviation is measured by goniometer. And here this is equinus deformity. Based on the center of the calcaneum, you can measure the amount of deformity. This is minus 20 degrees, 0, 20, 45 and 90 degrees. So minus 20 to 0, grade 1. 0 to 20, grade 2, like that. So again, varus also graded from the minus 20 to 90 degrees. And horizontal plane evaluation of derotation of calcaneopleoidal block, that is adduction. These deformities also calculate from minus 20 to 90 degrees. This classification is useful for postgraduates. For undergraduates, just remember Demigler classification system. Coming to the treatment, the aim is to achieve plantigrade, planeless, pliable and cosmetically acceptable foot with minimum intervention in shortest possible time. Plantigrade foot means you must achieve 0 degrees dorsiflexion foot. So I already told you the foot is in a forefoot is in pronation in relative to the hind foot. So hind foot is in supination, forefoot is in pronation. So onset developed a system, onset developed a technique so that all deformities can be corrected at a once. So non-operative, coming to non-operative treatment, forcible manipulation, these are done by Buckner and Thomas. These are outdated, not done routinely. And splintage, Whitman strapping, Kite's method, and Ponseti method. Out of all these, Ponseti is the only one now used. Rest of the other techniques are not used nowadays. These are Robert Jones splinting. And this is the Dennis Brown splint. I will explain later. So cast application tips, these are important ones to prevent any complications or another deformity, to prevent another deformity due to the conservative management. So every manipulation must be gentle, and the anesthesia is not required. And a child is fed before the manipulation, and child kept in preferably in mother's lap. And the correction is gradually, means over the weeks. It takes serial castings, that is around 4 to 8 weeks, depend on the amount of deformity. So no need to correct the deformity at once. The correction must be gradual. So cast application with minimum padding, means extra padding will loosen the cast, and molding around the heel, always above knee except final weight bearing cast. So the cast is always applied up to the level of groin. Why? Because due to the activity of the child, the cast may be loosened and it comes down. And if you apply a below knee cast, the cast may be loosened and it comes down. So apply the cast up to the level of groin with 90 degrees of knee flexion, and watch for circulatory embarrassment. So check the nail bed feeling regularly. That is important. And watch for retraction of the toes. So Kite developed a technique. He begins with correction of the forefoot adduction, later heel varus next, and finally equinus correction. So Kite advocated POP cast application and correction of deformity by wedging. So you apply a cast, and a wedge is wedge shape cast is removed on the opposite of the deformity. And correct the deformity and apply again another layer. So based on the application of the cast and taking a wedge, the deformity is corrected. But what happens in Kite is mostly rock bottom foot occurs. Because why? Because he applied a gradual pressure at the calcaneocubital junction. So the deformity is not completely corrected, and equinus also, there is a break at the level of the metatarsals. And a common complication is rocker bottom foot occurs in Kites. So it is an outdated procedure now, not doing. So Ponseti technique is simultaneous correction of the deformity. That is, I already told you the movements are kinematically coupled. So if you want to produce abduction, the foot is automatically goes into dorsiflexion and eversion. So here in CTV, the foot is in adduction. So you need to produce a abduction. So because of this correcting the adduction, the rest of the deformities will corrected, that is heel varus and keel varus is also corrected. So calcaneum is rotated along with midfoot. So here the lever is around the talus. You put a thumb at the talar neck and apply pressure on the middle aspect of the foot so that calcaneum will rotate under the talus, rotate horizontally under the talus so that deformity can be corrected and normal talocalcaneum angle achieved. So is the Ponsetti pioneered in CTV correction by his own technique. He corrected even recurrent and relapsed cases with conservatively with this technique. So here the pressure is applied on the talar head and you hold the foot like this and gradually here the pressure is applied over the talar head and this is the cavus deformity. First one to correct is the cavus deformity. Cavus, next adduction and lastly equinus deformity, varus and equinus deformity. Remember the term caves, C-A-V-S, caves. C for cavus, A for adduction deformity, V for varus, E for equinus. So caves. So first one is correction of the cavus deformity. Cavus deformity is corrected. As I already told you, cavus is due to the flexionate torso, flexionate torso metatarsal junction of first torso metatarsal joint. So first you apply a pressure over the bottom of the head of the first metatarsal. So that cavus can be corrected. It appears that deformity is increased, but you are producing the pronated foot in alignment to the supinated hind foot. So hind foot is supinated and the forefoot is pronated in CTV. So with this cavus correction, whole foot is in supination. After that, you correct the adduction deformity by gradually abducting the deformity. Here, you put counter pressure at the talar head and the calcaneum and the forefoot, hind foot, you gradually abduct the foot so that calcaneum will rotate under the talus and cavus is corrected and at a time adduction also corrected. So abduction, gradual abduction. So you produce a gradual abduction from this stage to this stage. And this is a serial casting method that every weekly cast is changed and the deformity correction is increased. Correction of the deformity is done regularly 1 week. After the completion of full attained abduction around the 70 degrees, the equinus part is corrected by dorsiflex the whole foot, not the front of the foot. Dorsiflex the whole foot produce equinus correction. If the equinus is not corrected and it is resistant, you will do a tenotomy of the tendinitis. Means the peritoneum of the tendinitis is cut and through a needle so that relaxation can occur. After the completion of this correction, Dennis elbow brace is applied. This is Dennis Brown brace is applied. This is, look here, after completion correction, the foot is in 70 degrees abduction. And the both feet are abducted, it is a bilateral. Or if another foot is normal, it is kept in neutral. and the, there must be space between the both the foot. Why? This space is equal to the amount of the distance between both shoulder. This brace is worn until the age of 18 months. Until the age of 18 months, both 24 hour night and day, 24 hours sleep. After 18 months, when child is able to stand, the brace is applied night time only, up to the 36 of months. The chances of recurrence after 36 months of complete treatment is very, very less, according to Ponsetti. This is the club foot, ankle foot arthrosis. This is the correction of the abduction. As I already told you, gradually abduction correction. And this is the correction of plantar flexion. And this is the shapes of cast after the correction. This is the first cast. It is in the cavus. It's gradually abducted up to the 70 degrees. Coming to the surgical treatment. Surgical treatment can be done in a resistant and relapsed or recurrent cases. Resistance means the deformity is resist to correct. Means with the conservative treatment, the correction of the deformity is very, very less. That is resistant case. Recurrent means even after full correction of the deformity, after few months, the deformity again occurs. That is a recurrence of the correction. Resistant means the deformity resists to the correction, conservative correction methods. Relapse means the treatment is not completed, but the first deformity recurs. The first means if cavus is corrected and you are gradually abducting, but a cavus again occurs. It is a relapsing case. So in all these cases, surgical treatment must be done. So, such commonly done is postromedial soft tissue release, that is turcose release. This can be done in cases less than 3 years. Tendon transfers can be done if the age is greater than 5 years. And osteotomies can be started after age of 3 years. Dilbin Evans procedure 4 to 8 years. Vegetasectomy 8 to 11 years. And last final procedure is triple arthrosis greater than 12 years. So these are the surgical procedure names. Turcose procedure, modified turcose, McKay-Simon, modified McKay, Jess means external fixator, and osteotomy means Dwyer's, Dilwyn Evans, supramalar, and triple arthrosis. So postromedial soft tissue release, that is turcose procedure. All the structures on the medial aspect are released, that is ligaments, tendons, and joint capsules, everything on the medial aspect and posterior aspect are released. So posteriorly, tendo achilles is lengthened, ankle joint capsule is released, talofibular, calcaneofibular ligament is released, talotibial ligament is released, and distal fibular ligament and subtalar joint capsule are released. Medially, tibial is posterior and FDL and FHL. I already told you FDL and FHL forms a knot at the base of the foot around at the first metatarsal. These two tendons cross, which this is called, this area called master knot of Henry. This must be released, and superficial fibers of deltoid ligament must be released, not deep fibers. And talonavicular release, spring ligament, that is calcaneonavicular ligament, and any abnormal insertions, abductor hallucis, and subtalar joint capsule release, and inferior extensor retinaculum is released. And not on in severe cases, not only medial aspect, lateral aspect also release can be done. It is calcaneal cuboid complex, lateral subtalar, and peroneal sheath release can be done. And plantar release, that is, on the plantar surface, the plantar fascia is also contracted. So release of the plantar reponeur is called Schindler procedure. And intrinsic muscle of foot are also released. Long plantar and short plantar ligaments are released. And the choice of technique depends on the age. Below 3 years, soft tissue procedures. Above 3 years, soft tissue plus bony procedure can be done. Over 10 years, triple arthrodesis is only treatment. This is the picture showing the Turcos procedure. That is postromedial release. We gave incision along the tender Achilles border and curved towards the first metatarsal. All the structures on the medial aspect are released. This is Cincinnati incision. Cincinnati incision is given in medial and lateral release. Both medial and lateral release is required. This is Cincinnati incision. It starts just below the medial malleus and curves posteriorly and ends at the level of lateral malleus. Coming to the GES, in resistant and neglected cases, neglected means no treatment is received in the past. So those cases are called neglected. You can do an external fixator like GES fixator. GES means Joshi external stabilization system. And another one is universal mini external fixator. 86% of the power of gastrosolus is retained. And another one is Elisero. Elisero is a very cumbersome procedure, but results are very, very much promising. Delvin Dwyer's osteotomy. You remove a wedge-shaped block from the calcaneum for varus correction. Delvin's Evans is calcaneum lateral wedge is removed. Triple arthrodesis means arthrodesis of the talonavicular, calcaneal cuboid, and subtalar joint. After 10 years, no tendon procedure or bony procedure is satisfying. So, after 10 years, the only procedure is triple arthrodesis. This means fusion of three joint. Arthrodesis is fusion of the joint. Triple means three joint. That is talonavicular, calcaneal cuboid, and subtalar. So these joints are fused in a plantigrade foot, plantigrade and neutral foot. So recurrence is reappearance of the deformity after apparently good outcome. So these are guidelines. Sometimes the recurrence may be isolated deformity, means complete all four deformities may not recur. If only adduction deformity recurs, metatarsal osteotomy can be done. The minimum age limit for age required for this correction is 5 years. If there is a isolated hind foot varus, modified Mekkes or Dwyer's or Delvin Evans or triple, if the age is greater than 10 years, triple arthrodesis can be done. For equinus, if it is a mild, TA lengthening and posterior capsulotomy is enough. If the weakness is severe, Lambrudini procedure is done, means remove a wedge shape of bone from the talus. So if the wedge shape bone is removed from the talus so that the deformity can be corrected. So I already told you resistance means does not respond to non-operative treatment seen in severely deformed or in arthrogryposis multiplex congenital disease. Recurrent means whose deformities are recurred, results if not properly maintained. So first to recovery the equinus. Neglected means present late or never treated. Thank you.
Teacher.